going to pick up at verse 21 of Daniel chapter 11. So if you will, turn there if you'd like, and you can follow with me. And I think you definitely will want to have your Bibles open tonight so you can keep up with some of the things that we'll be looking at a fairly quick pace tonight. So Daniel chapter 11, verse 21. And in his place shall arise a vile person to whom they will not give the honor of royalty. But he shall come in peaceably and seize the kingdom by intrigue. With the force of a flood they shall be swept away before him and be broken, and also the prince of the covenant. And after the league is made with him, he shall act deceitfully, for he shall come up and become strong with a small number of people. He shall enter peaceably even into the richest places of the province. And he shall do what his fathers have not done, nor his forefathers. He shall disperse among them the plunder, spoil, and riches, and he shall devise his plans against the strongholds, but only for a time. He shall stir up his power and his courage against the king of the south with a great army, and the king of the south shall be stirred up to battle with a very great and mighty army, but he shall not stand, for they shall devise plans against him. Yes, those who eat of the portion of his delicacy shall destroy him. His army shall be swept away, and many shall fall down slain. Both these kings' hearts shall be bent on evil, and they shall speak lies at the same table, but it shall not prosper, for the end will still be at the appointed time. While returning to his land with great riches, his heart shall be moved against the Holy Covenant, so he shall do damage and return to his own land. At the appointed time, he shall return and go toward the south, but it shall not be like the former or the latter, for ships from Cyprus shall come against him. Therefore he shall be grieved and return in rage against the Holy Covenant and do damage. So he shall return and show regard for those who forsake the Holy Covenant, and forces shall be mustered by him, and they shall defile the sanctuary fortress. Then they shall take away the daily sacrifices and place there the abomination of desolation. Those who do wickedly against the covenant he shall corrupt with flattery, but the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. And those of the people who understand shall instruct many. Yet for many days they shall fall by sword and flame, by captivity and plundering. Now when they fall, they shall be aided with a little help, but many shall join with them by intrigue. And some of those of understanding shall fall to refine them, purify them, and make them white until the time of the end, because it is still for the appointed time. Then the king shall do according to his own will. He shall exalt and magnify himself above every god, shall speak blasphemies against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the wrath has been accomplished. For what has been accomplished, what has been determined, shall be done. He shall regard neither the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any God, for he shall exalt himself above them all. But in their place he shall honor a God of fortresses, and a God which his fathers did not know he shall honor with gold and silver, with precious stones and pleasant things. Thus he shall act against the strongest fortresses with a foreign God, which he shall acknowledge and advance its glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many, and divide the land for gain. At the time of the end, the king of the south shall attack him, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind, with chariots, horsemen, and with many ships. And he shall enter the countries, overwhelm them, and pass through. He shall also enter the glorious land, and many countries shall be overthrown, but these shall escape from his hand, Edom, Moab, and the prominent people of Ammon. He shall stretch out his hand against the countries, and the land of Egypt shall not escape. He shall have power over the treasures of gold and silver, and over all the precious things of Egypt. Also the Libyans and Ethiopians shall follow at his heels. But news from the east and the north shall trouble him. Therefore he shall go out with great fury to destroy and annihilate many. And he shall plant the tents of his palace between the seas and the glorious holy mountain. Yet he shall come to his end, and no one will help him. At that time Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. And at that time your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the firmament, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. But you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Let's pray. Our Father, thank you now for your word. Pray that you would help us as we seek to understand the things, the lessons that you would have for us to derive from this part of your holy word. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want to begin kind of with an illustration. It's something that I want to give credit to having read something where someone did something like this that I'm going to do to try to illustrate this. And I'm going to draw from that, but kind of put it in my own way and be a little more modest in the amount of the period that I want to try to cover. But let's imagine that you have a book that was written by a man who lived in 1700. Okay? He lived in 1700. And it's a book about a prophecy that he was given about the 13 colonies and what was going to happen up to a certain time of about 100, 115 years beyond the time in which he was living in 1700. Now, I don't want you to misunderstand me. I'm not saying that there is such a thing or that we should ever expect there to be such a thing. But just for the sake of illustration, the sake of argument, here you are living today and you know something of the history. We know something of the history of what happened. Because it's all happened now. It's all in the past. But here is this prophecy that was given in 1700. And it goes like this. Now remember, it's a prophecy given in 1700 of what will happen in America in the century or so to come after that. Behold, As I was strolling along the river, suddenly I was in a trance and a vision was given to me. Now, as I read this, I want you to see if you can pick out what this is talking about, okay? I heard a voice from heaven saying, three more rulers will sit on the throne of England. Then a fourth will arise who will go mad and be overthrown by a man not yet born. This mighty man will be born in a land named after a virgin. He will first wear red and then wear blue, as he will rise up to overthrow the ones who once clothed him with honor. This ruler will stand head and shoulders above the rest, but he will refuse the throne. Instead, a new kingdom will be established. It will have three thrones, like the three branches of a tree, and the executive shall be his. After him, on the river Potomac, other governors will arise, one from the north, then one from the south, and then another from the south. Both governors from the south, also from the land of a virgin, like the first ruler. When the fourth arrives, the third after the first, the throne of the mad king across the waters will rise again. But a rough-hewn man from an unknown land full of volunteers will stand up and defeat him, fixing a final break between the old world and the new. Now, if you're here tonight and you know absolutely nothing about American history, then this quote prophecy would be extremely mysterious, right, and hard to understand. And depending on how well you know American history, in some ways would determine how much of that you are able to pick up and decipher. If you know the history, it's not that difficult. The fourth king of England, who went mad and was overthrown by a man not yet born, was King George III. The man not yet born from a land named after a virgin who once wore red, but then blue, is George Washington. And the land of a virgin is Virginia. His refusal to take the throne and instead establishing of a new kingdom with three thrones like the three branches of a tree, of which his shall be the executive, refers to the establishment of the new American government with its three branches, the executive, the legislative, and the judicial. The governor from the north, and then from the south, and then another from the south who followed him, refer to, can you guess? John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison. And the throne of the mad king across the sea, rising up again, who is defeated by a rough-hewn man from a land of volunteers. Refers to the War of 1812. The rough-hewn man, you might know who that is? Andrew Jackson. The land of volunteers? Tennessee. All right? Well, as we return to our study of the book of Daniel, this 11th chapter is something like that. When you first read it, it can all seem terribly confusing, but some knowledge of what actually developed and happened in history after Daniel's time makes it much more clear. And of course, this is real prophecy, not imaginary. And it's amazingly accurate prophecy, as we saw in our consideration of the first 20 verses of this chapter last week. So in our study of Daniel last week, we came to this 11th chapter where we have this revelation given to Daniel. Daniel is writing sometime in the 6th century B.C. That would be in the 500s B.C. And it's a prophecy concerning important events that are to follow Daniel's day in world history, particularly such as have a direct bearing on the people of God. Now, my approach, as you know, it's been with all of these apocalyptic passages in the last half of the book of Daniel, is to try not to get too bogged down in all of the details. Our great concern is with the message and the lessons that are here for us. So my method, again, as it's been, is to give an overview of the content, to draw out some of the practical lessons and the relevance of all of this for you and me. Now, we got started on this 11th chapter last week. You remember I pointed out that much of the content is parallel to what we'd already considered in the vision that's given in chapter 8. The vision there, you remember, of the various world empires that would arise after the Babylonian Empire and lesser kingdoms that would splinter off and follow. And also the vision there in chapter 8 of that unusually fierce king who would rise up to persecute God's people, Antiochus Epiphanes, whom we learned about when we considered that chapter. But here we're given much more detail concerning the ups and downs, victories and defeats, schemes and conspiracies that will characterize this entire period of history. And instead of kingdoms or kings being depicted in the form of wild beasts or horns, the history is given in a more or less, at least more straightforward manner than before. And also in this vision, as I hope to show you, after mentioning the reign of Antiochus Epiphanes, it reaches beyond him to another figure like Antiochus and prefigured by Antiochus, but even more evil, who will rise up sometime prior to the final judgment, a person that I believe corresponds to the little horn, not the little horn in chapter 8, but the little horn in chapter 7. And I don't know, you'll have to go back and listen to the messages online to pick all that up. Now, the content of this chapter divides up under the following headings. The first two we've already covered. First, we have prophecy concerning Persia and Greece, verse 24. And this covers the period from 526 to 323 BC up to the death of Alexander the Great. Then we have prophecy concerning these ongoing conflicts between the kings of the north and the kings of the south. This keeps going back. Then the king of the north, then the king of the south, then this king of the north and this king of the south. North and south, that is, of the land of Israel. And this is after the Greek Empire breaks apart and splinters into various kingdoms. That's verses 5 to 20. We have there the prophetic record of conflicts between the Seleucid dynasty in the north and the Ptolemaic dynasty in the south. And this covers the period from 323 to 176 BC. And that's as far as we got last time. But now this evening, we're introduced to a new ruler from the north. We have the emergence of the one who came to be known as Antiochus Epiphanes. And this one man is given at least 15 verses from verse 21 to verse 35. And on that point, almost every scholar and biblical commentator is agreed. But then I hope to show that this then merges and bleeds into the description of another person like Antiochus and prefigured by him, who will arise sometime before the final judgment near the end of time, verses 36 to 45. So these will be our two headings this evening. First, Antiochus Epiphanes, verses 21 to 35. And then second, this later figure who is also sometimes equated with the Antichrist, verses 36 to 45. All right? So first of all, Antiochus Epiphanes. So in verse 21, we come to this new king of the north, this new Seleucid ruler, Antiochus the Fourth, also known as Antiochus Epiphanes. That's what he called himself. That means God manifest. And the God supposedly being manifest by him was Zeus. He's not saying he's a god, but he's the manifestation of Zeus. He referred to himself as Antiochus Epiphanes. However, some of his contemporaries gave him the nickname Epimanes, meaning madman. We learned about him back in our study of chapter 8. And so picking up with verse 21, and in his place, that is in the place of Seleucid the Fourth, where we left off last time, shall arise a vile person or a despicable person to whom they will not give the honor of royalty, but he shall come in peaceably. Or it could be translated, he shall come in without warning or while the people are at ease and seize the kingdom by intrigue. Now again, this is Antiochus. Epiphanes is alluded to here. He didn't actually succeed to the throne. It should have been belonged to his nephew Demetrius, the son of Seleucus the Fourth, but he weaseled his way in by a series of crafty moves until the throne was in. It would take too long to go into what all of those different crafty moves were, but he eventually weaseled his way in to the throne. And he now becomes the focus of this prophecy all the way down to at least verse 35. Now think about that. His short reign of 12 years gets a whole lot more attention than all of these other kings over a period of 355 years previously. Now, why is that? Well, if you remember what we considered back when I opened up chapter 8, you should know the answer is because this man was a notorious, raging persecutor of God's people. Now, let's just run through some of this quickly, as I did last week with the previous section. Davis, in his commentary, provides, I think, a helpful outline that kind of breaks the passage down into chunks. First, we have a synopsis of his reign, verses 22 to 24. And this sketches kind of his overall military success, the lavish rewards he showered on those he favored. Verse 22 says, with the force of a flood, they shall be swept away from before him and be broken, and also the prince of the covenant, which is possibly a reference to the Jewish high priest, Onias III, who was deposed by Antiochus and later poisoned. Verse 23, and after the league is made with him, he shall act deceitfully, for he shall come up and become strong with a small number of people. He shall enter peaceably even into the richest places of the province, and he shall do what his fathers have not done, nor his forefathers. He shall disperse among them the plunder, spoil, and riches, and he shall devise his plans against the strongholds, but only for a time. Now, after this synopsis of his reign, secondly, in verses 25 to 33, we have the objects of his hostility, which are two: the king of the south, verses 25 to 27, and especially the people of the covenant, the Jews, verses 28 to 31. And then in verses 32 to 35, we have a description of the cost of his savagery. And there we have a description of the suffering and the great price that the faithful in Israel will pay as they resist Antiochus's program. So let's pick up at verse 25. We'll just trace out some of this. Now, in verses 25 to 26, we have described a new campaign against the south. Remember, that's referring to Egypt. Because of the treachery of some of the Egyptian or Ptolemaic army, they were unable to stand against Antiochus, and the armies of the north will be swept away, and many will fall down slain, as the text says, and that is indeed what happened. Verse 27, Antiochus then entered into an alliance with Ptolemy Philometor, neither of them with integrity, but as the text says, they shall speak lies at the same table. And Antiochus' plans did not work out as he hoped. However, when he returned from Egypt, verse 28, a rumor had spread in Jerusalem that Antiochus had been killed. Now, when that news was spread in Jerusalem, there was great rejoicing in Jerusalem, in Israel, and also the puppet high priest who had been set up by Antiochus was slain, and some of his supporters were slain as well by some of the Jews. Well, Antiochus' heart, verse 28, was moved against the Holy Covenant. He was angry. He invaded Jerusalem. He looted the temple. He carried his treasures home to Antioch in Syria. And once again, then in 168 BC, Antiochus invaded the south. He invaded Egypt, verse 29. However, this time, as it says, shall not be like the former or the latter. Why is that? Verse 30, it's because of a delegation of Rome, from Rome that entered the conflict. Ships of Cyprus, it says, shall come against him. Now, again, that's exactly what happened. A Roman fleet came to greet him, along with the Roman general, Papilius Laenus. And he carried with him a Senate decree requiring Antiochus to abandon his designs on Egypt or be regarded as Rome's enemy. And this is coming from histories that have been written of the time. Antiochus said something like, well, of course, I must consult with my advisors. But Laenus, having a vine stick in his hand, drew a circle in the sand around Antiochus' feet and told him, you must decide before you step out of that. You got to love the Romans. They're arrogant, but they're kind of the Clint Eastwoods of ancient history. Probably would be true of the Spartans before them, but there's a little bit of that in the Romans as well. Well, Antiochus had no other rational option but to submit. Frustrated in Egypt, then he erupted in what has been described as maniacal fury against Israel. Verse 30b, he intrigued with Jews who had forsaken the Holy Covenant. And these were Jews who had given up their faith and who sympathized with the Hellenization process that was going on in the region. In other words, the incorporating of Greek thinking, Greek religion, Greek way of life in the Holy Land, in Israel. And these were Jews who sympathized with that. And then in verse 31, he attacked Jerusalem, taking women and children prisoner. And no effort was spared by him. He sought to completely destroy the faith of God's people. The sanctuary was defiled. The sacrifices were abolished, as the text says, is exactly what happened. He abolished all the sacrifices. An altar, an image of Zeus, was set up in the temple. And pagan rites were celebrated on the altar. Some things I've read say that he actually offered a pig on the altar in the temple. And these pagan rites were celebrated, referred to here in the text, as the abomination of desolation. Verses 32 to 35 then describes the effects of this on God's people and the various ways the Jews would respond to what was happening. And we learn that some of the Jews were corrupted and apostatized, which is what happened, while others remained faithful. Verse 32, those who do wickedly against the covenant, he shall corrupt with flattery. But the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out exploits. Spiritually perceptive men instructed many in the truth, teaching them from the scriptures. And many of the faithful suffered greatly, and some were killed. Verse 33, and those of the people who understand shall instruct many. Yet for many days they shall fall by sword and flame and by captivity and plundering. Verse 34a, now when they fall, they shall be aided with a little help. When it looked like there was no more hope for the godly remnant, they were helped a little, which is probably referring to the Maccabean revolt that was led by Judas Maccabeus. It lasted about 6-7 years. There are many heroic deeds that occurred in connection with that, but there were many people involved in that revolt who joined up with the Maccabeans, who were really hypocrites. They weren't really truly godly people, but they joined up out of the fear of repercussions. And verse 34b says, as it says, but many shall join them with intrigue. In verse 35, and some of those of understanding shall fall. That means they're going to suffer. Some of them are going to die. Some of them are going to suffer in other ways. Some of those of understanding shall fall to refine them, purify them, and make them white until the time of the end, because it is still for the appointed time. But we can summarize all of this, I think, very simply in this way. During the awful days of the reign of Antiochus Epiphanes, some of the Jews were corrupted and apostatized. Some remained faithful and were strong in the Lord, many of whom suffered greatly. And some were martyred. And you can read about these events in history, that they actually did occur. Now, this brings us up to verse 36. And here's where it gets tricky. Here we have, secondly, another ruler. And this ruler is sometimes equated with what is sometimes referred to as the Antichrist. Now, most scholars, most commentators, conservative commentators, are agreed with me up to this point that verses 21 to 35 refer to Antiochus Epiphanes. But there's debate, there's a lot of debate and disagreement about what follows in verses 36 to 45. Verse 36 begins, "Then the king shall do according to his own will. He shall exalt and magnify himself above every god," and so on. Now, some argue that what may on the surface appear to be the case, that this is just a continuation of the description of Antiochus Epiphanes. Others argue that verse 36 begins a transition to another figure. Now, which view do I take? You can probably guess, but... Well, I take the view that here Antiochus begins to morph and to merge into the description of someone else or something like him in some ways, but it's not him. It's someone prefigured by Antiochus. But this description goes beyond anything Antiochus ever did and points to someone else who will rise up to trouble God's people, and this stretches beyond and to sometime after Antiochus, near the last day of history. Now, there are several reasons why I believe that. First, let me just say this. It should be pointed out that the ambiguity of the way verse 35 ends at least allows for this. This period of persecution under Antiochus has been described, and then verse 35 ends by saying that these things will happen until the time of the end because it is still for the appointed time. And that seems to be referring to the end of that period of persecution under Antiochus. And when it says in verse 36, "then the king," now if we've been following, you've been paying attention to the way this narrative has developed throughout this chapter, moving just seamlessly from one king to another, sometimes without making any distinction between them. It moves to one king without telling you now we're at another king. It just says, "and the king of the north, and the king of the south." And it goes on like that for 200 or 300 years, right? So there's no reason we're forced to believe that this must still be the same guy already described. So the language allows for this possibility that we're now talking about a different ruler. Now that doesn't prove it, but it allows for the possibility. Secondly, and this is much more conclusive, this king is described as doing things that Antiochus Epiphanes never did. For example, Antiochus never exalted himself above every god, as we're told that this ruler will, verse 35. He never rejected the god of his fathers, verse 37, or worshipped a god unknown to his fathers, verse 38. On the contrary, Antiochus worshipped the Greek pantheon and offered sacrifices to Zeus. Also, Antiochus never fully dominated the king of the south, Egypt, and her satellites, as we're told this ruler will, verse 40, and verses 42 to 43, and he didn't meet his end in Israel, verse 45. Antiochus died in Persia. So the description doesn't fit Antiochus Epiphanes. Therefore, I think we have to conclude that this king is not him. Thirdly, the destruction of this king seems to be described as something that occurs not long before, perhaps even just before, the resurrection and the final judgment. Remember, though we're studying tonight chapter 11, the first three verses of chapter 12 are part of this same vision. So after saying at the end of chapter 11, "yeah, he shall come to his end and no one will help him," the next words are, chapter 12, verse 1, at that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time, and at that time your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. It's talking about the final judgment, the resurrection of the dead. Now, all of this causes me to be convinced that this king is not Antiochus Epiphanes. is someone else that will rise up before the last day. However, there are definitely parallels, and the transition from one to the others is kind of fuzzy. It's as if they're almost presented as the same person, though they're not. In fact, we've already seen this in the book of Daniel, if you remember. Back in chapter 7, you remember we have a description of a little horn. And there we have that vision of the four world empires. You remember, you have the Babylonian, then the Greek. They're depicted by these beasts, these awesome, terrible beasts. And you have Babylon, you have Persia, you have Greece, and then you have the Roman Empire. And then you have kingdoms that spring out of the Roman Empire. And then you have a little horn, this evil figure who will rise up out of the many nations tracing their roots to the old Roman Empire. And we saw that this little horn clearly is a person who rises up near the end of history. But in chapter 8, you remember we have another little horn. He's also called the little horn. And he's much like the little horn in chapter 7, but this little horn springs out of the Greek Empire, the divisions of the Greek Empire after Alexander in that vision. So we have two distinct individuals who are both called the little horn. One we might call Little Horn Jr., and the other Little Horn Sr., or the little horn and the big little horn, right? The one prefigures and is in some ways parallel to and similar to the other, though they're not exactly the same. Now, that's consistent with what we see elsewhere in Scripture, in prophecy. For example, sometimes in the Old Testament prophets, David and Christ are almost presented as the same person. Have you ever come across that? For example, when Ezekiel prophesies of the coming of Christ, and he prophesies of the establishment of Christ's kingdom, he calls him David. Ezekiel 34, 23 to 24, I will establish one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them, my servant David. Now, David's been long dead and gone when Ezekiel gave this prophecy. He shall feed them and be their shepherd, and I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David, a prince among them. Now, of course, the Messiah is not actually and literally David. But he is from the lineage of David, and David prefigured him. Do you remember how the book of Malachi ends? The prophet says, in the last day, he's talking about before the Messiah comes, when the Messiah comes, that Elijah will come. Elijah will be the forerunner of the coming of the Messiah. Well, when we get to the New Testament, who's that talking about? Well, Jesus tells us who it was talking about. It was talking about John the Baptist. Not that John the Baptist is literally Elijah, but John the Baptist is a prophet who is like Elijah and who was prefigured by Elijah. And so the two are used interchangeably in that way in the prophecy, you see. And also these prophecies can sometimes have a double meaning. For example, Daniel, in verse 31, describes what Antiochus did when he desecrated the temple and offered pagan sacrifices on the altar. He describes it as the abomination of desolation. Have you ever seen that language anywhere else in the Bible? Well, Jesus picks this up as something that foreshadows something else, something that in his day was still in the future. He speaks of an abomination of desolation that is yet to come. Mark 13, 14. You see, one of the things we see in the Bible is that there are many Antichrist figures who rise up over the course of history. The Apostle John could actually say in 1 John 2:18, you have heard that the Antichrist is coming. Even now, many Antichrists have come. We might say that there is the Antichrist, and there are many Antichrists similar to him, preceding him, and prefiguring him. Well, that's what I believe we have here. Antiochus is an Antichrist. There have been many like him in church history and in the history of Israel. He is an Antichrist who prefigures the Antichrist. And the description of Antiochus now bleeds into and merges into a description of this other ruler who is yet to come. Now, who is this person? Well, various answers have been given throughout the history of the church. In the history of interpretation, apparently Calvin believed this to be a description of the Roman Empire. Some have interpreted it to be Muhammad, the prophet of Islam. Many persecuted Protestants during the early years of the Reformation, even on into the Puritan period, believed it to be a description of the papacy. In fact, when you read our confession, they believe that. That's why we have that exception. You know, if you embrace our confession, you can have an exception there. If you don't believe the Pope is the Antichrist, that's okay. But it wasn't that they believed a particular Pope was the Antichrist, though. It was the papacy as an institution that they understood to be what is spoken of here in Daniel. I think there are some interpreters who still believe that. However, many today understand this as a description of the final Antichrist at the end of time. And I lean in that direction since this description immediately precedes the description of the final resurrection in Daniel 12, 1-3. Now, what are we told about him? Now, we have to be careful here. This is apocalyptic, right? Apocalyptic prophecy. A lot of this is cryptic in style. And unlike the previous sections of this chapter, these are things that I believe haven't happened yet. We're more like trying to read that prophecy about the early years of the American colonies, and we're living before the time trying to decipher it, you see. So it's hard to be dogmatic. We have to be modest, tentative in our conclusions. But what are we told? Well, first of all, we have a description of his religion, which we might summarize as the worship of himself. That's his religion. Verse 36. Then the king shall do according to his own will. He shall exalt and magnify himself above every god, shall speak blasphemies against the God of gods. Now, that's language that ought to sound familiar to us. Think about the New Testament. It's very similar to the description of the man of sin in 2 Thessalonians 2, 3, and 4, where Paul writes, "Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day, the last day, will not come unless the falling away comes first and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshiped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God." And back to Daniel. Verse 37 goes on to say that he shall regard neither the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women. I'll come back to that in a moment. Nor regard any god, for he shall exalt himself above them all. Self-deification is his religion, we might say. But then after describing him as having no regard to any god but himself, the description seems to contradict itself, beginning in verse 38. But in their place he shall honor a god of fortresses, and a god which his fathers did not know he shall honor with gold and silver, with precious stones and pleasant things. Thus he shall act against the strongest fortresses with a foreign god which he shall acknowledge and advance its glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many and divide the land for gain. Now what in the world is that talking about? Well, some have understood this god of fortresses to mean the god of force, or that what we have here is a personification of war. The only god this guy has is war. Conquest. Quoting Kyle here, the god of fortresses is the personification of war, and the thought is this: he will regard no other god but only war. The taking of other fortresses he will make his god, and he will worship this god above all as the means of gaining world power. Of this god, war as the object of deification, it might be said that his fathers knew nothing, because no other king had made war his religion, his god, whom he honored with gold and silver, precious stones, and pleasant things. Now, if Kyle is correct, if that's the case, we can see how his devotion to the god of fortresses is really just another expression of his self-worship, his self-deification. Now again, remember, this is apocalyptic literature. How literal are we intended to understand these figures? What does this mean, that he honors the god of fortresses and of taking fortresses, and he honors them with precious stones and gold and all of these things and so on? I don't know, but whatever that means, he will clearly be an arrogant, self-exalting person thirsting for conquest and glory, who has no regard for the one true God. We might say that his religious doctrine or philosophy is might makes right. Whoever's in power determines what's right. Might makes right. Notice secondly, we have reference to his blasphemy and his lack of natural affection. We're specifically told that he will speak blasphemies against the God of gods, the true God. I think we can safely draw from that he will not be a friend of the church. He'll not be a friend of true religion. He will despise it and hate it, speak blasphemies against the God of gods. We also have this reference to his lack of natural affection. We're told that he shall not regard the desire of women. Now, what does that mean? Well, I'm not 100% sure, but it certainly is interesting, isn't it? Think about the fact that God made humanity at the beginning male and female. We didn't make ourselves into whatever we want to be. God made man at the beginning male and female. Equally created in the image of God, equal in dignity, though distinct in role and function. And God established the institution of marriage to be between one man and one woman. Well, in 2 Samuel 1:26, the phrase, the love of women, is used there to describe something that is something that's natural to men. Natural in its proper and wholesome expression. It's synonymous there with deep affection that is proper and natural and expected between a man and a woman, a man's wife. But this evil figure in our text will have no regard for that. Now, what does that mean? Will he be a homosexual? Will he be transgender? Or is this simply a way of saying that he'll have no affection for anyone but himself? Even that affection that remains in the most hardened and savage men, he will know nothing of. Not for mother, sisters, wife, no one. I don't know. You can choose which interpretation you think is best. A lot of these things, brethren, we won't know what they mean until they actually happen. Then we'll say, that's what I was talking about. But there will be something unnatural and perverted about this person. It seems to be the idea in that language. And then thirdly, we're told something about his progress. We're given this in verses 40 to 45a. We have this description of his conquest, and we have this picture of warfare, overthrowing countries, entering into the glorious land, planting the tents of his palace between the sea and the glorious holy mountain. Now, again, we have to be careful here. This vision of the future is presented, as Old Testament prophecy is presented in terms of the experience, the knowledge, the events, the geographical places that were of the time that was given. That's common in Old Testament prophecy. In other words, it uses language and concepts familiar to the times. It refers to places and nations that existed when the prophecy was given. If we take all of this with a kind of absolute literalism, we're going to get into all kinds of weird stuff. We're going to miss the purpose of the vision. For example, we have reference to the north and the south again, the Seleucids and the Ptolemaics. But those kingdoms aren't even existent anymore. Both will attack this person with chariots, horsemen, and many ships. But he will enter their countries and overwhelm them. Verse 40. Are we to think that the Seleucid dynasty and the Ptolemaic dynasty are going to rise again? Or are we to think that literal chariots, literal horsemen like they used in battles in the 6th century B.C. will be there? Of course not. But what we have here is a picture of conflict and warfare in the language of that time. If you look down at verse 41, it says, he shall enter the glorious land, and many countries shall be overthrown, but these shall escape from his hand, Edom, Moab, and the prominent people of Ammon. In other words, Edom and Moab and the prominent people of Ammon will be spared by him. They will not be overthrown by this person. Well, all the way back to the time when Daniel actually wrote this, Moab didn't even exist anymore. So we can't take this literally. But in the past history of Israel, to anyone who knew Old Testament history reading this, Edom, Moab, and Ammon were traditional enemies of the people of God. So the spiritual meaning seems to be that when this person comes, the only ones who will escape his fury are those like Edom, Moab, and Ammon, who are already God's enemies. Well, this goes on, tracing out his conquests. I think it's impossible really to decipher it all, to interpret it all with any degree of certainty. I don't think we're intended to do so. Other than, here we have warfare and conflict and conquest. Now, are these literal military conflicts? Well, I think that's included. Or is this spiritual warfare? Well, I think we have to at least allow for that possibility as well. Indeed, I think certainly at the very least that too is included. The real war that Satan fights with the church is never to be thought of exclusively in military terms, though the Bible often used military terms to describe it, even in the New Testament. Quoting Sinclair Ferguson, "The principle that might makes right is as often manifested in financial, intellectual, and moral terms as it is in military terms." And we have to remember, what did Paul say, for example, in 2 Corinthians 10:4? He said, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God." And also, you remember when describing the man of sin, the Antichrist, in 2 Thessalonians 2, Paul tells us how he will be destroyed. And how does he say he will be destroyed? By the Spirit, or by the breath of our Lord's mouth. So we're left with a lot of mystery here. We have to be content with that. God has told us everything that we need to know, so that when the time comes, we won't despair, and we'll know that God's in control. But at any rate, verses 40 to 45 go on to describe this ruler's dominance and international conquest. And then, praise God, we have reference to his end, his termination. The last words of verse 45, it's all very unceremonious, which I like that. It's not a big dramatic thing, because it's not dramatic to God. It's no big deal to God. It's like a mosquito on his arm that flips it off, right? Last words of verse 45, "Yet he shall come to his end, and no one will help him." Well, brothers and sisters, that's a lot to take in. But let's pause now to ask ourselves, what are some of the lessons we can take from this? How should all of this affect us? That's the point of the narrative. It's not just so we're able to trace out every single detail of everything that will ever happen in history. But what's the purpose of this? What's the effect? What's this revelation intended to do for us as God's people? Well, first of all, I have two things. First of all, it's intended to prepare God's people then and to prepare us now for this fact that there are difficult and awful days to come for God's people. Now, that may not sound very comforting, but it's intended to fortify us and to strengthen us and to brace us to endure them when they do come. Davis tells about the German theologian Helmut Thielicke. In his autobiographical memo, he reflects on what kept him from falling for Nazism in the days of Hitler's rise to power, while there were other professed Christians who did. Well, he said this, that he was one of the few people who had actually read Hitler's Mein Kampf. That was his political manifesto that he had written way back in 1925. And Talek said that having read it, the style and content of that book had to a certain degree immunized him against Nazi theology. Since he had read the book, he knew what this guy was really about and who he really was. Well, in a sense, that's what this prophecy is intended to do for God's people, to prepare us and to fortify us against such days when they come. This was true of the Jews during Daniel's time. It was true later during the time of Antiochus Epiphanes. Daniel might have been tempted to think, now that the Jews have been allowed to go back to Jerusalem by Cyrus the Persian and to rebuild the temple, there's nothing but wonderful days ahead. Glory times ahead for the people of God. But God reveals to Daniel and to those who would read this prophecy that times of trouble for God's people are not over yet. Now, when Antiochus Epiphanes arrived on the scene, speaking his blasphemies, desecrating the true worship of God, hundreds of years later, those who knew God's word were not taken by surprise. They were prepared. And no doubt it was a great comfort to them to read this prophecy and to know that none of this was taking God by surprise. It was all part of God's unfolding plan. When it says in verse 33, "And those of the people who understand shall instruct many." Well, it's not hard to believe that Daniel chapter 11 was part of that instruction. Be encouraged. See, this is exactly what God said would happen. Don't give way to despair. Don't give way to unbelief. Don't become disillusioned. Don't cave in to the pressures to compromise. And when it says, "But the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out exploits," no doubt this is part of what they knew and what enabled them to be strong. This is what enabled them to endure suffering and even some of them to die a martyr's death under the savagery of Antiochus rather than to be unfaithful to God. And the same is true for us. As this prophecy moves on beyond Antiochus, you know, it's easy for us to think, boy, we live in modern times now, living in America, these kinds of things will never happen to us. Or we have the very convenient modern kind of Western idea of the rapture, which means before anything gets bad, we're all going to be taken out and everything's going to be great. We're not, if you ever, you know, without going into demonstrating from the scriptures why I believe the Bible doesn't teach that, just think about this. Why would one generation of Christians be expecting that we're not going to have to suffer like every other generation of Christians has throughout history? God's going to take us out so that we don't have to suffer. Well, that doesn't jive with what I see in Scripture at all, or even what I see here in this passage. And it's for us as well. The same's true for us. Dear friends, you may not be in total agreement with every part of my interpretation of this chapter, and that's okay. Listen, if you have a better one, I'll be glad to hear it. You know, it's interesting when people say, "Well, I don't believe that." You want to say, "Okay, well, what do you believe? What do you believe?" So, in other words, if you got a better one, I'm all ears. I'm ready to hear your interpretation. But none of us should disregard the teaching of God's word that there are suffering times yet to come for the Christian church before Christ returns. The word of God tells us that the last day will not come until there is a falling away first and the revealing of the man of sin, the son of perdition. 2 Thessalonians 2:3. And while there's a sense, Revelation 20, in which Satan is restrained after the first coming of Christ, specifically with reference to keeping the nations in darkness, Revelation 20 also teaches that before Christ returns, there is that little season when Satan will be released. And he's described again in apocalyptic language. He's described as going out to deceive the nations and to gather them all to battle to surround the camp of the saints. And it will look like the church is done for, just as it looked like Christ was done for when he's hanging on the cross. And even before that time, and before the final Antichrist, whatever or whoever that might be, we're taught that many Antichrists have come and no doubt will continue to come. And then that last period of trouble will be worse than anything the church has ever experienced. The persecution will be unprecedented. Now think about that. If you know anything about what the church has already experienced in church history, it will be unprecedented. My dear friend, that's why being a Christian is no joke. That's one reason we must have a serious approach and attitude toward the Christian life. So much of modern Christianity today is marked by frivolity and silliness and shallowness. But brothers and sisters, if you're going to stand against the evil day, you better get dead serious about your faith. And you better examine yourself. and make certain that you really are in the faith, that you really are in Christ. It's not looking good for the Christian church right now, even here in America. And it'd be wonderful, I could say, like the false prophets did in Jeremiah's day, don't be afraid. It's all going to get better. God's going to wipe out the Babylonians. It's not going to happen. Can't say that. It may get worse. It may get a whole lot worse in the days to come. Worse than we can even imagine right now. Don't know. But this is why, as Jesus said, that we must count the cost of following him and recognize how much we need his word. So I don't really need his word. I don't really need to be under the ministry of a faithful ministry of God's word. I can get by without that. Don't fool yourself. That's why we need his word. That's why we need his spirit to strengthen us and preserve us. This is why it's so important that we're on our knees in prayer. When the real pressure comes, listen, when the real pressure comes, casual, half-hearted Christians will prove not to be true Christians at all. Just like it happened with the Jews when Antiochus came. Just like them, as we saw under Antiochus, they will do wickedly against the covenant and be corrupted with flattery and fall away. May God grant that that won't be you, that it won't be me. Secondly, and lastly, we're reminded again in our passage this evening that even when difficult times come, we can know that our God is in control. It's all the outworking of God's perfect plan for the glory of his name and the ultimate salvation of his church. Satan and his lackeys can only go so far. They're always on a leash, God's leash. There's this little refrain that keeps coming up through the reading this evening. Did you notice this little refrain that keeps getting repeated? Did you notice it? It's the refrain, for a time, or the appointed time. Verse 24, Antiochus is scheming, he's conniving, he's doing this evil thing and that evil thing. However, the verse ends with these words, but only for a time. In verse 27, he's doing this and that, but then we read, for the end will be at the appointed time. Verse 29, at the appointed time, he shall return and go toward the south, and so on. Verse 35, until the time of the end, because it is still for the appointed time. And then as we get to the last king, the fiercest of them all, at the end of verse 36, we read, for what has been determined shall be done. Now, what is all of this telling us? Who has determined? Whose appointed time? God's appointed time. As another has put it, all of these tyrants march to God's calendar. He is using them for his purposes. They can only go so far, only as far as God has determined. When I was a little boy, I lived way out in the country, about 12 to 15 miles from the closest town. And when I was little, I had to get up real early in the morning, walk down a long driveway to the end of it's about three pastures. I walked down to the end of the driveway to catch a bus. A lot of times in the dark, the bus would pick us up. And by the time we got to school, you've been on the bus for an hour. By the time we picked up everyone and we got to the school. And I remember those old buses. I guess they still have this. They had a governor on them. You say, well, what is a governor? Well, I'm not sure I actually know what it is, but I know what it does. Maybe some of you that work on cars can tell me what a governor actually is and how it works. But a governor was something that kept the bus from going too fast, right? You're going down the road in the school bus. You know, you want the driver to, let's pick it up a little bit. He puts a foot on the gas. It takes off, and then it gets so fast, and all of a sudden it just kind of flattens out. And it won't go any faster because it has a governor on it. And that governor will only let the school bus go so fast. Well, my dear friends, that's one of the points being made in this passage. The enemies of God, the Antiochuses of the world, and those who are yet to come are under the control of a governor. They can only go so far and do so much, and that governor is God. And as this vision will move into chapter 12, it will show us that ultimately God and His Christ and His people will win in the end. And it will be worth it all when we see Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, I hope this hasn't been too mind-boggling. If you've noticed in the last couple of weeks, if you've seen me and my eyes are kind of bugging out, my hair is kind of disheveled, I've spent 2 weeks digging through this chapter, and it's been quite an experience. But I trust that there have been nuggets of truth and blessing that God has brought to your soul from our consideration of this portion of God's Word. I'm going to pray now, and after I pray, I'm going to ask Carmen Leon if he'll come to the platform. And we have the privilege tonight of recognizing, as you know, we have an advisory ballot each year normally, and we get advice from the congregation that way. And then also we are always evaluating the men that we have in terms of their qualifications, their proven character, their service in the church. Then later, if we believe someone is qualified to be a deacon, we nominate them, and the church determines by electing this person. And I just praise God tonight that the church has seen in Carmen what we've seen in him, and that God, he's been a servant of Christ for many years here in the church, and he's been serving in so many different ways. And we just rejoice that God's raised him up to serve now in this special way in the office of deacon in the church. So I'm going to pray, and then after I pray, Carmen, if you'll come to the front, I have some questions I want to ask you and ask the congregation. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you tonight for your holy word, how it comforts us and how it builds our faith and strengthens us. And we pray, Father, that you would help us to stand against the evil day, to be faithful to you, to know that you are the governor and that you are governing all things according to your plan and your purposes, which will culminate in the ultimate good of your church, the glory of your name, and the victory, the total, complete victory of the kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We praise you for that. We thank you for our salvation. And now we ask that you would meet with us tonight as we recognize the hand of Christ at work in our church in calling out Carmen Leon to serve in the office of deacon. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.